What did you think about Biden getting busted with classified documents?
Ah,
kind of hilarious.
It is one of those funny moments, right? You know, regardless of I don't think they're not going to knock down the doors at the University of Pennsylvania where they found these things, right? At some think tank that they'd set up, and so that's not going to happen. But it is kind of fun to look at and think, oh, really? But the truth is, it happens with every administration, right? Document control isn't that difficult, right? You should be able to know which documents are secret, put them in a box over here, top secret over here, and then special code word, put them over here. And you account for all those documents. That's the way that you do it. But it seems like every administration has this problem.
What do they do at the think tanks?
Oh, there's a lot of ruminating. A ton of ruminating.
It's nearly 10 documents.
Almost 10. It's 7.
Yeah. One was incomplete. One they hadn't finished yet.
What does that mean?
Yeah. Nearly 10.
Nearly 10. Oh.
Yeah.
That's, if you say nearly a million, I'll go, wow, that's pretty impressive. You say nearly 10. I'm like, can you count? Tell me the number, you fuckheads.
It was the Penn Biden Center for Diplomacy and Global Engagement.
So what happens there?
Mm.
What happens in one of these think tanks? Is it just a way where people get money?
Yes. Yes. People.
You said yes so quick.
Yeah, that's it. You know, people get grants, you know, or they get a position there. They get the chair to sit for a year and study some particular, you know, esoteric aspect of whatever the hell it may be, global.
How much money goes there?
Well, that's, you know, some of these get a great deal of funding. And actually, that's an interesting point, because sometimes the funding comes from unusual sources, like perhaps the Chinese.
Really?
Yeah. That might be the soonest I've ever brought up China.
Really?
One of our conversations.
So the Chinese might be funding a think tank that has classified documents in it?
Oh, sure. Yeah. I mean, I don't know.
But it's not outside the realm of possibility.
It's not outside the realm of possibility. And you know, it'd be interesting to know who or where funding has come from for the Penn Biden Center.
$54 million in Chinese gifts.
Gifts.
Donated to UPenn, home of the Biden Center. What the fuck,
wow,
man? $54 million in gifts. It's just like, you know, yo-yos and shit, Xboxes,
beer koozies.
What the fuck are they giving them?
Raked in a total of $54.6 million from 2014 through 2019.
Wow, so $10 million a year.
Look at that.
In donations.
Anonymous gifts, $23
million. Anonymous. $23 million in anonymous gifts.
That to me is more interesting than the fact that he had almost 10 documents there. Because, again, every administration does it. It would have been amazing if Biden hadn't had classified documents sitting somewhere. President Obama had the same issue. Every administration, just because, again, it's this goat rope upon exiting and then before the new administration comes in, right? It's just like this funhouse of activity trying to box up all your shit and get it. And so that in itself is not a surprise. It's a surprise that, you know, with Trump, they decided to, you know, use a sledgehammer to go into Mar-a-Lago. But that's not going to happen with Biden. And it's an interesting comparison. But the Republicans thought it was an aha moment. I don't think they're going to get anywhere with that. I don't think people genuinely care.
But there's nearly 10 documents.
There's almost 10. And that one that's not completed yet, I think it's just missing, like, the pictures. It's just, everything's been written in.
What's crazy is that the documents being there are the big story, not that China gave them $50+ million.
That should be more of a story.
That's a big goddamn story. Yeah. And that seems to be par for the course, right?
Well, yeah, whether it's the Clinton, you know, foundation or initiative, or whether it's, you know, any, really, you know, pick any think tank. That would be a really interesting study by some intrepid, curious journalist who wanted to dig into the top 12 think tanks in America, and where does the money come from? And then compare that to what policies are they pushing out the door? Who are they trying to influence? Right? Because, you know, every one of these has some agenda or some point of view. So, you know.
Think tank sounds good. I'd love to be a part of it. Doesn't it sound good? What do you do?
Work for a think tank.
Oh, you must be smart as fuck.
I was going to say, it makes you sound intelligent.
Makes you sound like you're getting shit done. I'm working for a think tank.
Yeah. You know what I'm doing? I'm putting out a policy paper.
Well, now. So this Biden Penn think tank, what did they promote? Like, what did they? Let's see if we can find out what $54 million from China gets you.
Yeah, maybe we can find one paper that they wrote.
Yeah,
that would be good.
You know, Huawei ain't so bad. That's the name of the title. That's the title of the paper.
That's my Huawei. Yeah.
What's great? I was just reading about Huawei that even despite the U.S. sanctions, despite the fact that Google won't let them use the Google Android system or the Google Play Store, they're still killing it. They still have an enormous market share, which leads me to believe that if this didn't happen, they'd probably be number one in the world.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, it's...
Apple's got a nice walled garden thing going on, where it's like a buddy of mine, my friend Tony, just switched over to Apple's. I love when I get those new blue texts from people. I'm like, ha-ha! You went over to the dark side, you fuck. He was one of the last holdouts of the green bubble. But it's... They're so good at keeping you in there because your photos all go to the iPhoto and, you know, I use Notes, you know, like for comedy, it's like the best thing. But I also use Evernote. You can switch Evernote in between platforms, but it's so easy to keep people because there's so many benefits to iMessage. There's so many benefits to AirDrop.
And we're all fairly simple, right? Once you get into a habit, you don't want to change. It's like saying, okay, we're going to upend our computer systems at the company and go with a new product.
No,
don't really want to. So, with the phones, I mean, shit, we got for Christmas, we got the two youngest ones, Muggsy and Slugger, we got iPhones for them.
What if you got them Android phones? Would they freak out? Would they get mad at you?
Yeah, they probably would have thrown them at us. You know, just walked out.
What the
just stormed
fuck is
out
this
of the living
shit?
Room. You know,
if you had an Android Santa. Phone like we have today, if you had one of those things 10 years ago, you were a goddamn wizard.
Yeah.
If you had a Samsung Galaxy phone 10 years ago, like they have today, it would be the greatest thing ever.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
in 10 years,
no, it didn't take long, and honestly, you know, everything moves at this breakneck speed in technology, obviously. But you know, we debated for a while about the youngest one getting him a phone, right? But now he's old enough, right? He's 11, and he's going to sports activities and practice and everything. So from a security perspective, you have to do it.